Bob Wittman, David Kinney.
How you doing?
Hi.
Nice to meet you all. Thanks for coming. So the, I'm going to talk to you tonight about Devil's Diary, okay, a book that we just came out March 29th from Harper Collins. Where you are?
Say, I bought your book, and hopefully this is going to be like a movie trailer where you're going to tell us everything that's in the book and over the course of a minute or two.
Just a minute?
Well, I would have to assume, I don't normally buy books retail, okay? Certain books I do. And the last book I bought retail was 17 Carnations. So, yeah, there's some secrets in here that I can't wait to get to. I'm a little worried you might expose.
I don't think Bob's gonna tell her. You're not gonna tell everything.
What, 12 minutes?
Yeah.
It's only a 500-page book, right? Yeah. No, we're gonna talk together. The way we're gonna do it is I did the investigation when we had to recover the diary for the U.S. Holocaust Museum. I was an FBI agent. I retired in 2008 from Philadelphia. I was here an agent for 20 years. And my job at the FBI was to recover stolen art and cultural property. I was the chief of the FBI's National Art Crime Team. So what I did was paintings, documents, any type of cultural property. In many cases in the Philadelphia area, the Philadelphia Historical Society, we recovered $2 million worth of art stolen from there. Philadelphia Museum of Art, which I spoke at on Saturday, we recovered three paintings from them over the years, you know, different situations. So, you know, that's what I did. And in 2013, I was called by the, actually it was 2012, I was called by the U.S. Holocaust Museum to come back in and try to do a recovery of a piece that they had been looking for probably almost 15 years. And so it took a long investigation to try to find that. And what that was, it was the actual diary of Alfred Rosenberg. Now the book that you're looking at tonight, this is the U.S. edition. What you're looking at up here, this is the United Kingdom's come out. Germany will be out May 24th. France is already out. Came out March 1st as well. April 1st. And it's going to be published in 30 countries, 26 different languages. So Harper's done a really good job of selling it, put it that way, around the world. What we're going to talk about is, these are other books that we've done together. I've done Priceless, which was my memoir as an FBI agent, where I talk about all those cases we just mentioned in Philadelphia. David here has written the big one, which is about a, what's it about?
What, you didn't read it?
Twice. I'm going to let you tell.
The big one is about a fishing tournament on Martha's Vineyard, a saltwater fishing tournament. And then the Dylan book is about obsessive Bob Dylan fans. So naturally, my last book was about Nazis.
So Nazis and Bob Dylan.
Only in that I wrote them, so they're related in my brain.
Yeah. So
maybe writing stuff.
So we're just gonna have fun tonight, basically. We you know, this is our first event together that we've done. We're logged in with the Jewish Book Council at this point. We're gonna be doing that in May. That'll be like 100 different things we're about to do in the next year or so. So we're gonna have to practice this and get good at it. So just to let you know. Yeah, tonight, you're the first ones up. Well, this is a story. It's a story of the Nazi diary of Alfred Rosenberg. And Dave is going to tell you about who Alfred Rosenberg was. Want to do that?
Yeah, it sounds good.
All right, so there's your first
So this is a palace in Bavaria where Rosenberg's diary was found in 1945, right at the end of the First World War. The U.S. Army is sweeping through Germany, and they're trying to get all of the documents that they can get about Nazi Germany. Anything they can get their hands on, they want to collect it for intelligence, and then also they're already thinking about war crimes trials. And so this guy, Kurt von Baer, lived in this castle at the end of his life, and he approaches the American military governor in the area as soon as the Americans arrive and says, I have a cache of documents that you'd be interested in. If you'll let me stay in the castle, I'll show you where they are. And so, the Americans go and take them there.
A little bit by way of background, Von Baer was actually, wasn't he the guy, he was the guy in Paris.
Yeah, he had a career during the war of running the art crime operation out of Paris.
So you saw a monument man?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He was the guy who was stealing the art.
Oh my God.
In Paris.
And showing it to...
And a lot of other stuff.
Yeah. He was showing it to Gordon. The Goering.
Goering.
Yeah, he was showing it to Goering, and Goering was taking his parts. I remember in the movie, he was the guy in the Paris who was running the gallery. And ultimately, he left Paris with train loads of art and took it different places.
So he ends up in this palace and gives up the secrets. They find all of Rosenberg's papers, like 250 boxes worth of records, including this diary. And I guess the deal that he hoped to cut, and he's basically trying to save his life, it didn't go through. He and his wife go to a bedroom in the castle and get some champagne, put some poison in it, and
commit suicide.
End their lives.
Yeah.
In typical Nazi sort of melodrama.
If you ever go to a Bavarian, you can actually visit the castle. It's still there.
This is Bonn's Abbey. It's known as. It was a lot of different. It was a palace. It was a monastery. Now it's a church.
Oh my!
That would be cool,
wow.
Right?
It's not.
So Rosenberg, as it says here, was there from the start. I mean, he is Estonian by birth. A lot of people think that he was Jewish because of the name. He was not. It was a common enough name among ethnic Germans. The day, a few weeks after...
This is Rosenberg here.
Right here. A few weeks after World War II, World War I ends, he gives this incendiary speech in his hometown in Estonia about the evils of the Jews, the evils of the communists, and that night takes a train to Berlin.
This is World War I?
At the end of World War I, so we're 1918. Arrives in Berlin, doesn't like the looks of Berlin, ends up going down to Munich and falling in with the right-wing nationalists in Munich who are now trying to take control of the country, which is how he ends up meeting Hitler at the end of 1919, the dawn of the Nazi Party. He's there, and he's an important figure because in this era, Hitler is still sort of figuring out what he believes, working out his platform. And Rosenberg, this virulent anti-Semite, this enemy of the communists, is feeding him his ideas, and Hitler is lapping it up. And so contemporaries at the time thought that Rosenberg had sort of outsized influence over Hitler and the direction of the Nazi Party, much to their chagrin.
I like the Daily Beast wrote a piece about this, about the book, and they said they titled it "The Man Who Made Hitler into Hitler." Mm-hmm. So really, it's interesting. I mean, after the roles changed after 1923-22, of course Rosenberg became the most loyal ally of Hitler and became his ally and oldest friend. But in the beginning, hey Pam. What are you doing? I want to see you for a second. Pam Stratton's an FBI agent. She worked with me for years. Many years. Yeah, and she's a writer too today. So great to see you, Pammy.
She's going to keep you honest.
Yeah, it's great. Let's see. I got to give you a kiss. You're going to go to shoot Saturday?
Yes.
I'll be there.
Okay.
Give me the name of that sheriff's guy up in Delaware County so we get this thing signed. Okay. We have to get our license to keep our guns. So we'll do that. Anyway, what was I saying? Oh, yeah, Rosenberg. In the beginning, Rosenberg was actually... the leader, and Hitler was kind of his acolyte. That's where he was getting his ideas from.
Is Hitler
saying
in that picture?
Hitler's not in this picture. This is great. Actually, this was a German day in a city called Coburg, and the Nazis drove their enemies, the communists, off the streets with these batons. Rosenberg didn't participate because he brought a gun instead of the required club.
Right.
But he was there.
Yeah, so he was the one in the beginning who was creating Hitler, into Hitler.
Did Rosenberg, do you know if Rosenberg reacted negatively to Hitler taking his power position away from him?
I think it was more of a collaborative thing. So
yeah.
Hitler is there, he's this charismatic speaker, everybody sort of recognizes. There were a lot of nationalists in Munich, there were a lot of different groups, but Hitler just had this charisma, this speaking ability, and the political instincts, you know, that appeared later on.
What's interesting too about that though, is that when Hitler actually went to the first meeting, I guess it was the socialist group, the socialist party, he was there as a spy for the police,
for the army.
For the army, he was there as a spy to see if these guys were, you know, simmering discontent, you know, against the army. So he was actually on the other side.
But then he sees this right. nascent Nazi party as something that he can control, and it becomes his vehicle.
It becomes
his vehicle to success.
And of course, at that point, Rosenberg is the editor of the Nazi newspaper. So that's how they become very good friends, and he's got a lot of influence because he's writing all the articles that they're reading, and he's the one that's influencing what the articles say. Down the road, a number of years later, of course, the famous books, and I saw one over here, Mein Kampf, of course, Hitler's memoir and tome, basically sold millions of copies in Germany. And interestingly enough, the only other book that sold a million copies at the time was also Rosenberg's book, which was called The Myth of the 20th Century, which many people said was unreadable. those were the two greatest selling books in Nazi Germany that nobody read. That's how I've seen it described. In other words, everybody had to own one, but nobody really read them.
But it gave Rosenberg cachet.
Right.
So he's around this time, Hitler has appointed him, the Nazis have taken over, Hitler has appointed him his ideological delegate. And so Rosenberg has this best-selling book, he's got this high-ranking position, and this platform, basically, this voice to be the guy who is determining what's the right way to understand Nazi thinking, giving it sort of an intellectual background, a pseudo-intellectual background.
Exactly.
And so he's this guy who appears on the radio. He is welcomed with bunting in crowds when he goes and appears places. And when Rosenberg speaks, people feel that this is kind of a right-hand man to Adolf Hitler. So he becomes a very influential figure in Nazi Germany.
And in fact, at one point, Nazi Germany was against the Nobel Prize. And they didn't want to participate in that whatsoever. So what they did was they created their own, what was it called, the German National Prize. And Hitler decided the first recipient of the German National Prize would be Alfred Rosenberg. Mm-hmm. And that came with, a million marks, right?
I think it was 500,000.
Was it 500,000?
They were upset because the Nobel Prize I believe it was 1935, to a pacifist that the Nazis had jailed, named Karl Setzky.
Right. So in response to that,
they boycotted it.
Yeah, they boycotted and created the German National Prize. First recipient would be Alfred Rosenberg. And at one point, to show his influence in the party, Hitler was wounded, was shot and wounded after the putsch, or the revolution in Munich, and as a result was arrested. As he went to prison, he made Rosenberg the head of the party. Because at that point, he said, I'm in prison. If something happens to me, you take over. You'll be the head of the party. We don't know why. There's a lot of reasons why. Maybe they thought maybe he was weak. Hitler thought maybe when he came out, he'd be able to take back over easily. Or it could be that he thought he'd be gone, and Rosenberg was his only ally. So at that point, that's how much he thought of Rosenberg, was to make him the head of the party. And what we're doing, we're trying to explain why it's so important. It was so important to get this diary back, who this guy was, that we can learn so much from him. Still a messenger of hate. Here he's sitting at you can see Rosenberg sitting right next to the Fuhrer at this meeting. All the major, it's Rudolf Hess right there, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah.
And Goering
over here. So this is the rallies in Nuremberg. And of course, he's sitting right next to the Fuhrer in the front row. It just shows how close they were.
Is Martin Bormann in that picture?
That's a good question.
Bormann may not have been, Dave, because Hess hasn't left yet.
This is pretty early. This is 1934.
This is before Hess left, defected. And so Bormann kind of took over when Hess made that vacuum. And that was a bit later, 40?
This is Goering's here.
Yeah. Who's the guy on the end? That's somebody, too, right here.
Right here? This is Goering.
Goering, yeah. And where's Goering?
All the way on the other end.
Down here, okay. Yeah. Himmler's not in there. So, what a group, huh?
What a group.
So you see, he still was the loyal fighter throughout the years. This is 1938. Remember, he started in 1918. So all the way through, this is 1938. This is Rosenberg's 45th birthday party. And the guest of honor, of course, who showed up at the party at his house was the Fuhrer himself. So and gave him a gift, which he, what was the gift? It was, do we remember?
I believe it was more money.
There's more money.
$250,000. We should back up because we haven't. So now we're already at 1938, but if we back up, but he starts writing the diary in 1934.
Right.
And throughout the diary, he says, I'm not a natural diary writer. I have no interest in keeping diaries. He wrote you know, books, pamphlets, memos, voluminously. He wrote perhaps more than any other Nazi during the span of the Third Reich. And so I was trying to figure out like why he took this up, and I think the answer is also in the diary. His main rival as sort of the ideological chief in Germany was Joseph Goebbels, who was the propaganda minister. And Goebbels and Rosenberg viewed their job as the same job. They were out to try to win over the souls of the German people for the Nazi Party. They had totally different approaches. You know, Goebbels was this cosmopolitan figure, a, you know, acid-tongued speaker. Rosenberg was more stodgy. He was more tradition-based. And so they just clashed from the beginning. And interestingly, the month that Rosenberg starts writing his diary, Goebbels has just published his own entries from 32 and 33 showing how important he was to the rise of the Nazi Party. And so my thinking is that Rosenberg was trying to basically compete. He's thinking, I'm a man of history, I need to write this diary and leave a record behind so that people will, you know, in future generations will care about what I think.
Right, right. So he could have been competing, or it could have been figuring he's going to leave something for the future, which is right. But yeah, but I don't think he wrote it for publication.
It's hard to know. I mean, it's
but just because of the way he did it.
He was an undisciplined writer. So Goebbels wrote almost every day. Right. When he stopped writing, he would dictate it to his secretaries. Rosenberg left behind this diary that has long gaps, and you know, sometimes I'll read about something an incident that others have left letters behind or have written memoirs about, and it's richly detailed, and then I'll read Rosenberg in another one paragraph, and I'm just so frustrated.
Can he speak German?
Rosenberg?
Yo.
Do I speak German? No, I do not.
So Rosenberg was also the chief architect of the Führer Museum. He was the person who was creating taking the artworks for the Führer. So all that material that was taken out of Paris, out of all of Europe, was Rosenberg's group. It was his. He was in charge of that group to gather that artwork and take it back to Germany. These are a few of the paintings, and of course, not only that, he was also involved in the Operation Furniture, which was to take all the furniture as well. So you know, people like in Monuments Men, people read about Monument Men, they think about the artwork that was stolen from Europe. That's taken a lot of the publicity and whatnot. But the truth was, they were taking furniture, household equipment, forks and knives, everything, because as Germany was being bombed by the Allies and losing the war, everything was being destroyed. So what they were doing, Rosenberg's group was shipping millions of trailer carloads of this material back to give to the German people as well.
And keeping some of it for themselves.
Of course, yeah. I mean, here's another, you know, this is just furniture that they took and taken as well. And keeping it for themselves, the best stuff they kept for themselves, to put in their villas. You know, in
there were reports that Rosenberg got like huge shipments of towels and sheets and bedding.
So he picked what he wanted as he went along. And even today, this still goes forward. This was April 12th. This was actually recovered. It was being offered for sale at a gallery in Austria, at an auction house. And the French government requested that it be taken off sale and returned to the Louvre because it was stolen from the Schloss family in Schloss collection. So this piece is just April 12th, this was done. Mm-hmm. So even today, we're still feeling the effects of Rosenberg's deeds, you know, during the Second World War before. It just keeps going on and on. In fact, this morning.
Where had it been, if you know?
This was in Austria. And
in private hands.
Private hands in Austria. And just this morning, three paintings were recovered by the Carabinieri in France, I mean in Italy, that were stolen from the royal family of Luxembourg by the Nazis. And they were taken as well.
Do they get money? Do they get compensated if they have to return the painting?
They were stolen.
They were stolen to begin with.
Yeah, but I mean, how did they get them? I mean,
Yeah, there are people who...
It's a hopelessly tangled mess.
Yeah.
You end up with people who say they purchased it in good faith, not knowing of the provenance.
The provenance.
Yeah, it's a paint by numbers.
Yeah, but if they're stolen, they're stolen. I mean...
And that one had been... This one had been on the list for a long time, since the 40s.
It was
known that this was...
Same with the three today that were recovered in Italy. They were on the list as well. So they had been missing. I think it took 13 works from the castle from the Prince of Luxembourg during the middle of the war, and these all are on the list. So today they found these three that the Carabinieri recovered. So it goes on today. I mean, it's not It's not something that happened 60 years ago and went away. And it's 70 years later, and we're still dealing with the effects of all this situation. He became a Reich minister.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, Rosenberg, all his, he had this reputation of being a philosopher, a writer, a thinker, but not somebody who could actually run anything. And so he was actually a party official for years and years and years. Finally, in 1941, Hitler agrees to make him a Reich minister. So it's his first official government position. And he's putting him in charge of the political administration in the occupied territories of the Soviet Union. And so Rosenberg, I mean, this is the job that he's wanted. You know, this is his chance to redraw the map, get back at his enemies, the Jews and the communists, all in one fell swoop. And there's an entry in the diary where he talks about it. Why don't I read it? Should I read it?
Sure.
Where it sort of shows his megalomania. He says Hitler's just told them that he's going to give him this role. They have a dinner in the Reich Chancellery, and then afterwards he rushes back and writes actually his second entry of the day, which is very unusual. And he says, "There's no need for me to express my feelings at greater length. 20 years of anti-Bolshevist work will now have their political world historical consequence. Millions and their fate will be placed in my hands. Germany will be delivered for centuries from a burden that always in various forms weighed upon her." And this shows his sickness. What does it matter if millions of others will curse the enforcement of this necessity if only a future great Germany blesses these deeds in the future? So he wished that his ministry was that omnipotent, that all-powerful. But in Nazi Germany, everything was shared. And so Hitler had given Himmler the role of perpetrating the Holocaust. He'd given Goering the job of exploiting the Soviet Union of their raw materials and their food for Germany. But Rosenberg's political administration, he fought for a role, and his local administrators, had thousands of them throughout the Ukraine, the Baltic states, Belarus, and they were deeply implicated in all of what happened there. So that includes the shootings that went on. There was more than 1 million Jews who were shot in the first stages of the Holocaust. This is even before they moved to gassings. He was, they were involved in recruiting the Slavic people and sending them to Germany as forced laborers. They were involved in all of that stuff. And one of his men told him towards the end of the war that if Germany loses, you're going to be hung.
Well, the thing, and I think it's really crazy about this whole thing, too, is that, as I said earlier, you know, Hitler was almost an acolyte of Rosenberg in the very beginning. And, you know, Hitler, when he got first, what was it, Munich, when he first met with these guys, he was actually an artist. He was selling art in his hometown to Jews. He was friends with the Jews in that area. They were his, his collectors. And so, when he gets to Rosenberg is the one who's saying that it was a global Jewish conspiracy that created the Communist Party that was the Bolsheviks. And he blamed everything, all those problems, on the Jews and convinced Hitler of that. So ultimately, it was Rosenberg's ideology, it was his ideas that created the Holocaust. He was one who convinced that that was the correct thing to do. And one of the things about the book that you'll see, which is I think is really eye-opening, is how a civilized Western, you know, industrial scientific society can get involved in something like this and allow it to happen. I mean, the German people, not the Jews, the German people themselves, they closed their eyes to it. All right, I mean, and so I was talking to Henry Mayer, who was a chief archivist at the U.S. Holocaust Museum, and he said to me one time, you know, Bob, it would be almost as if you lived in Philadelphia and all the African Americans were taken out, okay, in a course of a month, and they just disappeared. And, you know, that's more than 50% of the population. And they just disappeared. And he said that all their stuff was just sitting there. And little by little, they started taking the stuff and trucking it away. And nobody knew where they went. How could you not know that something was going on? You see? And that's not, and there were some towns in Germany that's exactly what happened. 50% of the population just disappeared. And so,
including the town where his ancestors came.
Including the town where Henry's ancestors came. So how could that happen? You know, with how can a guy like that convince an entire nation, you know, of millions and millions of people, to accept that kind of a situation? And when we see that,
didn't you say it was huge?
Yeah. Huge. Did you say it was huge?
Yeah. Huge.
It's
huge.
A little. Today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like getting 7-Eleven, you know, messed up at 9-11. It's, you know, that's what you're talking about. But again, he, you know, he did this, and when we look at today, you know, here's some of the you know, rhetoric that we're hearing.
Yes.
It's scary. It really is. It's too frightening, and how there's the fear mongering can create the atmosphere of acceptance, and that's why it's really, when you read this book, I would say to you that if you're an academic. If you're a Harvard history professor who studied World War II your entire life, there's only a few things in here you may not know. But if you're a normal person like us, you know, if you want to read a book, okay, about World War II and understand what happened from 1919 to the end of the Second World War and all the way through up until 2013, so how far we go with this, if you want to understand the greatest cataclysm in human history, where more people were killed in one event than ever before, ever, okay, this will give you the idea. This will bring it up to you. So you, it's done in a way that's not academic. We wrote this as two biographies. One biography of Rosenberg tells you who he was, because you have to understand that. The second biography of the man who stole the diary, okay, and where that, how that happened, where that came from, and then as a true crime where we do the detective work to recover the piece. So it's a multifaceted story, not just, you know, one historical item about the war. It's all these stories, all intertwined together. It's almost like the Red Violin. Did you guys see that movie?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas
yeah.
The diary itself is the violin, you know, mm-hmm. But you see how it affects people all the way through. So, yeah. Well, this is Rosenberg. Ultimately, he was put on trial at the Nuremberg trial. You want to tell about that?
Well, yeah, so the guy who said he was going to be hung was correct. You know, Rosenberg, a couple of weeks after the war ends, he's arrested. He's taken to a hotel in Luxembourg that's been stripped of all its luxuries with Goering and a bunch of the other major war criminals, where they cool their heels until the trial is ready. In Nuremberg, he put on a pretty despicable defense. I mean, he said that basically he didn't know anything about the Holocaust. He said he didn't never set foot in a concentration camp. He said he never called for the biological eradication of Jews. He said a lot of things. And the judges, you know, weren't having anything of it, and convicted him, sentenced him to hang. And it's interesting because, you know, as I said earlier, he's the most prolific writer in the history of the Third Reich. Pamphlets, books, speeches, just he spends his entire life talking. But as they bring him out to the prison gymnasium where they've set up the gallows and put the shackles on his hands, and he walks up the 13 steps, everybody else had something to say. He was the only one of the 10 who were condemned that night who were hung who had no more words. He had nothing else to say. So that was interesting.
Yeah, it was interesting, too, that the chief prosecutor, Robert Jackson, at the Nuremberg trials, called him the
intellectual high priest to the master race.
Yeah. Intellectual high priest of the master race, which is an interesting comment. But it was, you know, the other interesting thing about it was he was prosecuted by an individual who had gone back to Germany, Robert Kempner. And that's the other biography that we talk about in the book. Robert Kempner was a Jewish attorney. He was living in Germany. In fact, he fought for the Germans in World War I, so he was a veteran soldier. And he was actually the minister, what was he? He was the Prussian police litigator.
He was a lawyer in the Interior Ministry.
In the Interior Ministry for the police department, for the Prussian police. He actually worked for the government, of course, but he was Jewish. So ultimately, he had leaved Germany because he was basically, he was thrown out, you know. He wanted to leave rather than be put back into a concentration camp. Went to Italy, and then from Italy went to France, and then came to the United States, where he lived in Philadelphia. He worked at the University of Pennsylvania. In fact, he had a job there. And the whole time he's at the University of Pennsylvania, he's contacting the FBI, you know, J. Edgar Hoover. He's talking to J. Edgar Hoover, trying to tell him, I can help you with information about these individuals in Germany, in the Nazi Germany, who are doing these war crimes. I can help you with background information on them. He's talking to anybody that will listen. And ultimately, all of his preening and going back and forth with these individuals, he actually is picked to go back to Germany during the Nuremberg trials to be one of the prosecutors.
Where am I going?
I don't know. Okay, his job was to look at the defense of these individuals who were on trial.
Yeah, he had a lot of different jobs in Nuremberg. I mean, he helped write trial briefs. He helped. He did a lot of interrogations. He was known as this aggressive interrogator, and he could sort of be obsessive about certain points. And because he had been there in Berlin through the 30s, through the rise of the Nazis, he only left in 36. So he had seen everything. He liked to say that he knew their sins, and so they didn't want to be interrogated by Robert Kempner because he could see through
their lies. Right, yeah. And in fact, he was close with a number of the Nazis himself. Was it Fritsch?
Rudolf Diels,
who actually plays a role in, what's the book? Erik Larson book.
In the Garden of Beasts,
yeah, he plays a role in there. Rudolf Diels was one of the guys who dated the daughter of the ambassador.
Right, he's the founder of the Gestapo.
Right.
And he and Kempner had worked together
in the
interior ministry. They knew each other, and both of them were sort of born conspirators. They were they loved an intrigue, and so they became close enough friends that Kempner got Diels off the hook at some point when he had an issue with a prostitute before the Nazis took over. When Kempner gets in trouble after the Nazis have come to power and gets thrown into a concentration camp, his wife-to-be turns to Diels to try to spring him. And then later on, when Diels is arrested, there's a thought that he might be charged at Nuremberg. Kempner helps keep that from happening. He argues that Diels is a valuable witness. We can't go after everybody. He was a good guy in the end. So they had a pretty complicated and interesting relationship. And that tells a lot about the kind of guy that Kempner was.
Yeah, he was a mover and shaker.
He was on the right side of history, but right. His methods were sometimes questionable.
Right. So, but he did go back as one of the prosecutors and was involved in the prosecution. Now, the diary itself was recovered by Patton's troops, Patton's troops, at the Bavarian castle. All that material was brought back to the Nuremberg trials and was looked at. It was all studied. And at that point, Kempner was using that material to prosecute these individuals with the other attorneys at Nuremberg. Now, you gotta remember, Nuremberg is very special, too. I mean, that had never been done before. There had never been a war crimes trial to put world crime people. You know, the Hague didn't exist at that point. There was none of that going on. So the idea of having a war crimes trial, and with having three sets of judges, it was the Americans, the English, and the Russians, and have three sets of judges and prosecutors actually involved in it. So it was a very, very novel experience. And having Kempner come back was a big deal for him. Now, while he was there, he had a number of aides, he had a wife, another secretary. In the end, Kempner had two mistresses and a wife all living together with him. So he was an interesting guy that way as well. You know? And that's all in the book's part of the biography. But what he did was, he decided he wanted to pack up all this paper he had, all this paperwork, and ship it all back to the United States. So he sent how many, I know you had, we had the number in there.
It seems like it was 29 boxes.
29 boxes. Yeah, but it was thousands of, 8,000 pounds.
Yes, something
of,
like that.
Of papers sent back to the United States, all documenting the trial. And in these papers were the original documents. I mean, he wasn't taking copies, all right? He took the original documents. One of the things that he took was the Rosenberg diary. The diary is actually about a 425-page diary, written handwritten, you know, in old-style German. It is it's actually separate pages. It's not like a book, like you think of, like, you know, a little diary book. It's pages after pages that he would insert and put dates on, and then he would write and then put something in there. It might not write for 2 months, and then go back and put it in again. So this was what the diary looked like. There was an estate problem. Kempner, kind of move forward a little bit. Kempner died in 1993, and he died in Lansdowne, Pennsylvania. Well, actually, his home was in Lansdowne, Pennsylvania. He died in Frankfurt. Lansdowne's right here in Delaware County.
Where did he die?
1993. And at that point, you know, his house was completely filled with documents from World War II.
I remember reading about that in the paper. He's the guy.
He's the guy. Right. There you go.
Where in
good
Lansdowne?
Memory.
Wow.
Or down?
Lansdowne. No, where in Lansdowne was it? What was the street?
Is it Lansdowne Circle? Is that possible? Or is my...
I don't mean to interrupt, but if I remember correctly, was there not some legal issue that he wasn't supposed to have done what he did?
Exactly. Well, his documents
These are public records. I mean, what happened was these documents were captured by the U.S. Army or by the Allied forces. And after the trials, they were supposed to go back to either the home countries or to the National Archives. And so a lot of this stuff ended up going straight to the National Archives, where it was sorted at this torpedo factory and then, you know, became an official public record. Eventually, the originals were sent back to Germany or to other home countries, and we kept copies at the National Archives. The Rosenberg diary, only a portion of it made it to the National Archives because Kempner left with the rest of it. And so it was seen by prosecutors, but nobody else got to see it before it vanished underground for 60 years.
Yeah, it was, and it was never transcribed or translated. So the historians didn't actually know what was in it. Why did he do it?
I mean, we only have theories. I mean, he was upset at the end of the Nuremberg trials. So the Nuremberg trials, and there was a main one, and there were some later ones. 1949, he does the last trial. By 1951, a lot of the people, all the people actually that he had convicted, were out of prison already. He was upset that others were never brought to justice. He was upset that there was already this sort of revisionist history going on where people were saying, oh, you know, it would have been okay if Hitler had just listened to the generals. Everything would have been okay. We would have won the war. And so he was already fighting against all of that stuff. He was like a harbinger of the sort of never forget movement. And so his argument was, well, I'm concerned. This is what he wrote in his memoir, or said in his memoir years later. He said he was concerned that documents would disappear, that in this environment, that important things would just end up being thrown in the trash heap or burned or whatever. Nuremberg was awash with paper. I mean, there was copies, there was original documents, there was a million people there, people were coming and going. So there's maybe some legitimacy to that argument. But really what he was after, I think, was exclusivity. Because he could have made a copy, he could have, at some point given it to the National Archives. He never did any of that. I mean, I think what he wanted was, it's 1949, I don't know what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. I have written some stuff, maybe I can use this stuff as material. He was trying to sell his own book. We know he was having conversations with publishers, he was trying to get a job as a professor. So there were a lot of reasons for him to want to have this sort of exclusive archive that only he could access. Mm-hmm. At a time when, you know, Nazi stuff was obviously everybody wanted to read. And so I think that's probably what happened. And then at a certain point, he ended up doing other stuff, and he only quoted a couple of things, you know, a couple entries of the diary and a couple of books that he wrote that were about other things. And then it was too late. You know, if he ever wanted to give it up, he was going to be in trouble. Yeah.
So when he died in 93, there was an estate problem. And what ended up happening, he had left his two mistresses there in the estate, and they were still living at the house. One of them was still living at the house, and they wanted to keep them in the house the way it was. But he also had two sons. He had two sons by the three ladies, one by his wife and one by one of the mistresses. The other one he didn't have a son with. But the two sons were the actual heirs of all the property. So at that point, the two sons deeded all of the documents, all that material, to the U.S. Holocaust Museum and gave it to them. In 97, the museum sent Henry Mayer, who was the chief archivist at the time at the U.S. Holocaust Museum, up to the House of Lansdowne to do an inventory. At that point, he said that the material in there was unbelievable. It was probably the most complete documentation of the Nuremberg trials anywhere in existence. But on top of that, it was just a hoarding nightmare. You know, the boxes were on top of boxes on top of boxes. So you had to stand on top of six boxes to get to the top three, and that's how the house looked. So it was a situation where they couldn't do it in one trip, they couldn't do it in one day. And yet there were still some legal issues as far as one of the mistresses was concerned. Ended up going to court. It wasn't until a little bit later that they were able to actually get custody of most of the material. Well, that's how I got involved. In 2001, I got a call from Henry, and he said that he had gotten a call from a picker here in the Philadelphia area, a guy who did clean out. You might remember this, Pam, because you were in the office with me when this happened. And anyway, so we did this little undercover sting at this Picker's place over on over off of 621, off by the airport in Essington. And we went down, and I and at that what I did was I introduced myself as an appraiser to look at the material to see what it was worth. He had called the museum and said he thought he had Rosenberg's diary. Because you see, all the material that the museum had gotten, the diary wasn't in it. So, you know, he was thinking, well, we've got this diary possibly. Is it worth $1 million? That's what they asked Henry. So Henry called us, the FBI here in Philadelphia, and at that point we set up this little situation to go look at it to see if we could get in to look at the material to see if it's worthwhile to seize it, okay, take it back for the government because it's government material. So we went in, we looked at it. At that point, we realized that there was some very, very important material. He actually had the original plans and documentation for Operation Barbarossa. Mm-hmm. This is the actual, real, original documents. Barbarossa was the attack on Russia. Mm-hmm. And these plans were about Rosenberg's ministry to find out what they were going to use, what they were going to do agriculturally, what they were going to take from Russia to feed their soldiers and whatnot. So we went in. At that point, we saw the stuff. We identified it. We called Henry. Henry was outside. And we brought Henry in to look at it. At that point, we were able to seize these documents. We took about 8 square feet of documents. It was a lot of material. And what this picker had said, he said that what happened was he was hired to clean out the house, and these documents were all on the back porch. All right, and as a result, since he was supposed to throw it all out and clean it out anyway, he just took it, and he saw the value because there were original documents that had letters in them with signed signatures from Germans, different German leaders and generals. He figured he could make some money. And he also thought he might have the Rosenberg diary. Well, unfortunately, we didn't have the diary in that grouping. We brought it all back to the office in Philadelphia. Ultimately, there was a civil situation, a civil litigation. The judge in Philadelphia ended up giving 50% of the documents to the Holocaust Museum and 50% to the picker because they had been abandoned material, is how it turned out. So we didn't do a criminal case, we did a civil case, and they ended up getting half the documents back. That was in 2001. Well, for the next 12 years, we were looking for this Rosenberg diary. We got involved with the Department of Justice, with the FBI office in Philadelphia, and also at headquarters, but we couldn't find it. Finally, in 2012, Henry calls me one last time. Now, I've retired in 2008 at this point, and he says, Bob, let's take one last chance and try to get this back. So he had a lead that he had gotten, and at that point, he gave me that lead. Now, I'm not going to tell you everything because you have to get the book and read it. Okay? But we did get it back, and it was very interesting how it worked out as far as the true crime part of this concern. But we'll let you know. Suffice to say, we did get it back. All right? And
otherwise, there'd be no book, right?
All right, exactly. There'd be no book.
That's remarkable.
So, how did you two meet each other?
You know, he and I? Oh, he's a journalist. He's
In Philadelphia?
Yeah, actually. We met through the writer of who helped Bob write his
Priceless,
which was about his FBI career, his 25-year FBI career.
Right. So we worked together with him, and then I was going to work with John to do this, but he wasn't available, so he introduced me to Dave. And Dave and I had the same agent, literary.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we worked together, and it worked out quite well. This is actually what the diary looks like. You get an idea. You see it's single pages. It's not necessarily a book, you know what I mean? At the top are the dates. And this German.
It's hard to know, though, whether some of it might have been torn out of books. It's hard to know whether some of it is missing. I mean,
we don't know.
One of the things that they were hoping was that the Holocaust Museum was very excited about this because Rosenberg was involved in key meetings in late 1941 with Himmler and with Hitler and with other top people at a time when the gas chamber idea was just being set into motion, and so there was a hope that historians are still searching for this Hitler order as if it if it existed, if it was ever put down in paper. And so I think the thinking was that perhaps the Rosenberg diary would hold that clue, but unfortunately there's a gigantic gap during the end of
was the diary used during the Nuremberg trials.
It was not. They had so much other
so
evidence
how did they
against
even know it.
It
existed.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm.
What do you mean?
Well, how did they know to look for it?
Well, remember at the beginning, they were gathering whatever documents they could. It was in with all of his official papers.
There's a list.
They knew it existed.
Your question was, it actually put into evidence? No.
No.
But that was read. It was looked at. But they didn't need the information to put it into evidence. They had enough. There's a difference between what they knew and what they used for evidence.
Right.
Yeah. So there was a listing of it. It did exist. They just didn't know where.
Yeah, well, it's quite remarkable that he himself didn't have the opportunity to destroy it.
You could say that about a lot of the documents in Nazi Germany. I mean, there was an order to destroy stuff, and some people went through with it, clearly. Others, archivists, took all the stuff, and, you know, their job is to save this stuff. I mean, it's built into their DNA.
Yeah.
Right. And for them to go through and destroy this stuff, so instead they chose to hide it. They buried it in the mountains. They put it in, you know, boxes and did whatever they could. And then, you know, tips would be passed around, money would be exchanged, and the Allied forces would find the stuff. But it's possible there's still stuff hidden.
Absolutely.
I can't remember. I'm sure the book points out. Where was Rosenberg when he was taken into custody?
Flensburg. So
north of Germany?
Yeah, it's right up near the Denmark border.
So he wasn't anywhere close to where this was?
No, he wasn't. They moved all the stuff south. Yeah.
Interestingly enough, you know, Hitler's photographer actually became very helpful in recovering material and explaining what was going on.
Yeah, these archivists would go with
the archive. Yeah,
they'd
German,
go with the papers and they'd organize it for him.
Hitler's archivist was very helpful as well. So.
Goering's historian, he was even working on a history of the German Air Force.
Right.
And he went with them and he was ordered to continue, finish your history. You know? And so
you might have seen this. This was 2013. This was at the U.S. Attorney's Office in Wilmington, Delaware. Because we ended up using the U.S. Attorney's Office there because a friend of mine, Dave Hall, remember him, Dan? Mm-hmm. Works at the office there. And he was the one who was working with me to get the piece back for the Holocaust Museum. And that's Henry at the press conference and the chief of ICE. And you can see it was a worldwide press conference when we recovered it. Because the diary, as I say, it was never translated, and it was never put out so people could understand what was in it. And in fact, so it was a brand new thing to look at. When historians find a piece of primary evidence, something that's a primary, you know, document from World War II, it's a big deal because they have to be able to understand it and pull it together. We actually had, three interpreters and the translators had to look at the diary and were able to translate it for us. We had the actual first English translation, really, when we got it done because we had a copy of the German diary. And it wasn't written in just normal modern-day German. What's the name of the language?
It was
an old German.
No, it's not.
I thought they had a hard time reading it.
They had a hard time reading because it was sloppily written.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
The scrawl was very difficult.
I thought it had like a Teutonic German or something.
No.
Like a high.
It was just very hard to read.
Well, that's why I was paying them more. So anyway, they translated that for us. We had three different ones do it, so we would make sure that everything was correct before we could put it into the diary. Now, what we did in that book, we didn't print the diary. What we did, we didn't contextualize the diary. So because it is broken up in many different ways, if you just read the diary, you'll have a hard time understanding exactly what he's talking about, okay? So what we did was we looked at the pieces that were put in, and then we would contextualize it with that date, what was going on, mm-hmm. and what was happening in the German, you know, whatever the situation was. And what you're gonna see is the Third Reich, the Second World War, from 1919 to 1946 through Rosenberg's eyes. Okay, it's basically through what he was involved with. So these events, you know, the Kristallnacht, the Night of the Long Knives, all these are events that he lives through as well, but it's through his eyes. Now, different people are gonna have different ideas. Himmler's thinking in a different way. Goebbels is thinking a different way. Goering's in a different situation. Even Hitler. But you're gonna see how Rosenberg saw it, which I think is really interesting since he was the ideological, you know, mouthpiece for the Third Reich. This is the Fisher Today shot. This was the Homeland Security agent who was involved in the case. His name is Mark Alexa. Dave Hall was the U.S. attorney. Myself, Henry, and my son Jeff was actually investigating the case through my company as well. But we were the ones who were able to recover it. And again, that's the motto of the U.S. Holocaust Museum. Ever again, and remember, what you do does matter. That's how they remember the situations that happened back then. And we talk about all that as well. So you have any questions?
Yeah, what was it like when you saw sun shining in after you came out from these diaries and writing this book? It took you how many years? Just 3?
2.5 years. Yeah, something like that.
So you really didn't do anything. I mean, how did you do all this?
That's the life of the writer.
That's what writers do.
You have good wives.
Right.
Great wives. They support us.
Yeah.
You mentioned people were buying Hitler's paintings. Do you have any idea if any of them still exist and where they are?
I believe there are still some.
Why was this sold recently?
Yeah, some of the paintings still do exist. I don't think they're not in museums. They're basically in private collections.
One of his watercolors was sold.
Yeah, they bring good money now, not because of value of them, not because they're good, just because of who did them. Signature.
On a little bit of a side subject, I was on YouTube and I saw a little clip, a documentary called "The Unseen Pictures of Auschwitz," and I think the copyright was 2008 when they got this. Are you familiar with it? The Holocaust Museum was sent a picture book that someone, again, had all those years and had somehow unexplained in the documentary had released it.
Yeah.
That it had conclusive evidence, for instance, that Dr. Mengele was, in fact, at Auschwitz. So my question is do you think there's more stuff out there that's hidden away?
I don't think there's any doubt. The difficulty is that there is so much paper and there's so much writing and so much research about Nazi Germany because everything wasn't burned, because the Allies got all of this paper, because the Germans wrote everything down, that finding some revelation that is going to be earth-shattering, I think, is going to be increasingly difficult. But surely there's other records. I mean, there was a story a couple of years ago of somebody renovating their property in Poland, I believe, or someplace in Germany.
Like 3 months ago.
Yeah, knocking through the wall and finding all of these documents hidden behind the wall.
Yeah, census documents.
So who knows?
In the Warsaw, it was the people in the Warsaw ghetto.
Okay.
The number names of the Jews.
You mentioned the picker, for instance, thought he might get $1 million. So.
Yeah. Well, and you know, I talked to Henry, and Henry tells me that all the time, if the Holocaust begins, GIs from World War II, they send material. You know, they have things that they have, like documents, books, that they send in. And things show up.
Souvenirs,
right? Letters from the war. Yeah.
There was a photographer on Sea Lion Avenue, right in Overbrook, and I remember when I was getting married, which was less than 30 years ago, him opening up the trunk of his car and all these pictures of Auschwitz. Like, I guess he was a photographer in the war or something. They were just pictures in his trunk of his car.
And the Holocaust Museum has grown and grown and grown. I mean, Henry's job, when he got there, I think he said there was something like 70,000 pages of documents in 1993 when it started. Now it's something, when he left, I think it was like 90 million pages. And, you know, as the last of the Holocaust survivors or the Holocaust generation passes away, you know, their heirs are going to start, you know, inundating the museum.
And they don't keep anything secret, right? I mean, whatever they get, it's always released. Right.
Yeah, it's a public archive. Yeah.
Right. It's a U.S. museum. It's like the Smithsonian. It's got some funding from the U.S.
government. Right. Some of the subjects.
And what they did with the diary. I mean, when they got the diary back, there was some pushback initially that, well, why aren't they releasing this? Why is it keep it still under wraps? What they did is the moment that the Holocaust Museum got it. In fact, before, they scanned every single page front and back, and posted online the day that they announced that it was being handed over to the Holocaust Museum. So they've been, you know, transparency is the thing.
Yeah,
they don't want anybody to say, but you're hiding pieces of it.
And interestingly enough, when we recovered it, the Holocaust Museum was the major push factor to get it back. But interestingly enough, it belonged to the National Archives. It didn't belong to the Holocaust Museum. Yeah. So what they did was they copied every bit of it, gave it to the National Archives, the copies, and then the National Archives then deeded it to the Holocaust Museum and gave it to them. So they had to
switch. And it leads me to believe, and not to sound the wrong way, but that the National Archives has got stuff that they're holding on to. That, you know, why trust them?
I don't have any reason. I mean, I wouldn't suspect that they're hiding stuff. I mean, it's possible stuff is lost.
Yeah.
In fact, I just read a story today that said that the Wright brothers' original patent has been located. It wasn't stolen, as you might believe. It was just misfiled. It was put in the wrong box, and people have been looking for it for like 30 years. So it's such a huge place. So.
Well, it's very great. It's really great that you wrote this book. I mean, I can't wait to read it.
Oh, great.
Thanks.
I still can't believe you did it in 2.5 years. That's a lot to go through, bro. I mean.
Yeah. That was a lot of,
Did you learn a lot of new things?
Well, I started in 2001. Well, not to write the book, to get the diary back. And it took us 13 years to get the diary back. And then for 2.5 years to write the book. So, 15 years. And Henry's been working on it since 1997, so he would have been 16, 18 years, you know, trying to get it.
So he was a contributor to the book, too, then?
His parts of his story are in there. I mean, he's a character in the book, absolutely, because he, you know, he was the one who was pushing to get it back. It was because of Henry Mayer that we got it back. You know, it was his push, you know.
There's so many books about people finding a book, you know, and it's, I can't remember the name of it, you know.
Were you on the job when the Hitler diaries were supposedly found in
the
course?
Fake ones? Yeah.
Do you remember that?
I think I retired at that point, but yeah, they were fake.
That was back in the '80s. I mean, there was
it was not long ago.
We have another question in the back.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
My question is: you said you had 3 German translators. And I would think that if you have 3 people, they don't always agree on the exact translation. Was that a problem?
No, it was fun, actually. It was really
interesting. It was fun?
Yeah, it was interesting because they were actually translating different sections of the of the diary.
Okay.
But when I would come up with something, one of them was younger and a little bit more colloquial, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have those translations reviewed by other people, and they'd say, well, I might do this, I might do that. I remember we had a whole debate about the German word Schlapp, S-C-H-L-A-P-P, which means weak or limp, or there was a bunch of different, we had a whole argument about how that word should be translated most appropriately. And there was another argument about, Kempner uses the word, I don't know how to pronounce it, I'm going to butcher it, but it's Judenweiber, I think.
Oh, yeah.
And it was translated as Jewish broads.
Right.
And he meant it in that sort of derogatory way, but it can also be translated, I guess, as Jewish women.
Yep.
And so the context was important. You speak German?
I do.
Okay, yeah. So the context, I guess, was important. So we had a little debate about how that should go. Mm-hmm. I thought that stuff was fun because
I think it's very
interesting. I didn't really know the art of translation. I figured, you know, the word's the word. And so they kind of clued me in on the idea that it can go a bunch of different ways. And so I did a lot of back and forth, rechecking quotes and checking it with multiple people and just seeing if we could come up with the right.
Was that the argument that Rosenberg had with Robert Jackson?
Yeah. Right, so he has a whole argument. They have this memo that where Rosenberg is meeting with Hitler in this time period that I mentioned in December of 1941, and he tells Hitler, well, I'm supposed to give a speech. And he says, you know, now I don't think, based on what's happened, and we don't really know what he's talking about when he says what's happened. He says, we shouldn't talk about the extermination of the Jews, is how it was translated. The word was
ausrotten? Ausrotten? They didn't want to upset the Americans.
Ausrotten? Which means like extermination.
Uh-huh.
And so he says, well, that word doesn't mean what you say. This is on the stand. He's having a debate with, you know, the U.S. Attorney General, essentially, Supreme Court Justice. And actually, what's it? I think it was actually Thomas Dodd who was on this debate with him, who was doing the cross exam for the U.S. And he says, "Are you being stupid, or you know, are you just wasting time? Do I need to bring out a German to English dictionary?" And so they have this whole debate about it.
Well, it's really difficult. I mean,
and during the trials, it was really hard
because
you had instant translation in 4 different languages. You had Russian, French, American, and German. Whole band of translators that were doing it on the fly, and everybody's listening in and complaining that, oh, you're translating it wrong, but it's moving so quickly that you're not really able to make your case.
Right.
So.
I think it's a real art to be able to capture not only the words, but the essence of what's being said.
Right.
And in the essence, that's where you have the problems.
Right. And a lot of times I would be, you know, I do not speak German, but I would be relying on multiple English language sources, quoting the same material four different ways. And so it's just a matter of, you know, if they weren't so wildly divergent, and often they aren't, I mean, these are academics or historians or translators or whatever, often they're pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a matter of style, I guess.
Well, I'm glad you had fun with it.
Yeah, no, I thought it was interesting. In fact, I thought it would be a fun story to do. Talk to somebody who is sort of the main, is there a celebrity translator these days in
mm-hmm.
a certain language? Somebody who's translated some best-selling books or something. It would be fun to sort of talk to them about how
mm-hmm.
that process works.
Was there anything in the book that you had to cut that you wish hadn't been cut by an editor?
Maybe kill our babies, right? Throw out our babies?
No.
Yeah.
No. I mean, it's always a struggle in that you write it one way and then first draft is always terrible, and even the first draft that you send in is not what it should be. And so there's never enough time built into the publishing process to rewrite, I find, because it takes maybe two sort of massive reworkings to get it into the shape that it should be in. And each time you need an editor to look at it and say, this doesn't work. And always there's one moment in the writing process where somebody comes up with something, the editing process, somebody comes up with something like simple but ingenious, and it was his wife actually who finally came up with the idea of moving the end of the book to the beginning of the book. I remember Bob came over to my house and we were just about to send it in. I was like in physical pain from working on this thing. I'm like, I don't want to do one more moment of work on this. But he was right, she was right, and so we spent another week doing that. And it really kind of changed the way the book worked.
I didn't want to spend another moment working on it either.
So,
it worked out. Yeah. It's tough. It really is. It's hard to. I know, Ben, you want to be a writer. You are a writer. You know how hard it is.
But fiction.
Yeah. Well, even fiction is even worse. You got to write the whole book. At least with the nonfiction, just do a proposal.
Plus, you have the empty page.
Yeah,
you don't have a notebook or something else. You just have the empty page staring at you. It's a totally different world.
Gotta come right out of here, you know. Yeah.
What kind of fiction do you do?
It would be thriller.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, Jerry's doing her book, Jerry Williamson. She's going to work on this stuff. So. See how that works out. But I think her agent's going to publish it for her, something like that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. He's actually doing it. This is an agent that actually does publishing too. So, you know, it's like self publishing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
They print it as they buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So we, Harper sold it 30 countries. It's going to be in 30 different, 26 languages.
Wow.
Right now, so like I said, it's in France.
Might have you read in German. Tell
yeah.
me.
Yeah.
Oh,
did.
My gosh.
May 24th.
You know, the Germans string the words
yeah,
together.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
one word is a whole paragraph.
She was wondering how we were going to pay her, by the English word or by the German word. We paid her by the German word. We paid her by the German word.
Is it?
And she was happy about that.
That's right. That's the German.
Rosenberg Papiere.
Papiere.
Nice.
Okay. Yeah. And what? Can you read that for me?
Oh my gosh, that's like
too small.
D.
Cover your right eye. Not
They're one row up, they can see a little bit better.
Eye test has been passed.
Yes.
Very good.
Well done.
Very good.
So was he, remember it was so much about Nietzsche and all those guys, so was he an avid reader of all these philosophers? Or?
Rosenberg?
Yeah.
He was, and the argument is that he didn't really know what he was self-taught, and that he didn't really know what he was getting into, he didn't really know what he was writing, and so it's sort of... The myth, the book that he wrote, The Myth of the 20th Century, was sort of this half-plagiarized ideas. You know, he was taking ideas from the 19th century nationalists and trying to modernize them. And it's just a muddled mess, really. His thinking was he's not a clear minded individual.
Not
good.
Wasn't a clear
footnotes.
No footnotes.
No annotated
bibliography. You needed
editing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks
for coming out.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
How often did you guys meet from the